Argentina, located in the southern tip of the Americas, was home to numerous indigenous communities, many of which were decimated by the Spanish colonizers during the 18th and 19th centuries. Independence from Spain in 1816 coincided with increased reliance on trade with Great Britain, and subsequent waves of European immigrants have melded with the remaining indigenous cultures to form a complex national Argentine identity. Contemporary Argentine history often begins with Juan Domingo Perón, president of Argentina from 1946 to 1955, and again from 1973 until his death in 1974. Perón is often considered a populist. His rhetoric was pro-worker, and his government created or expanded retirement benefits, healthcare and insurance, as well as women's suffrage. He was also an admirer of Italian fascist dictator Benito Mussolini, and Perón's rule was both authoritarian and repressive. His legacy continues today with the Peronist political party and its extensive network of punteros, neighborhood politicians who sell access to government money and services in exchange for votes for their party. After Perón's death, his wife took over the government until she was overthrown by a military coup in 1976. The dictatorship initiated a so-called dirty war against trade unionists, workers, students, leftist guerrillas, and anyone else who spoke out against the dictatorship. By the end of the dictatorship in 1983, 30,000 Argentines had been sequestered and killed. They are known today as the disappeared. The democracy which followed did not change many of the dictatorship's policies, particularly the neoliberal economic reforms. These reforms reached a peak during the presidency of Carlos Menem from 1989 to 1999. Menem sold off public utilities such as power, water, oil, telephone company, encouraged foreign investment, and drastically cut spending on social services such as healthcare, education, and social security. Argentina became a global poster child for neoliberal reform, but the economic impact at home was devastating, and social unrest increased rapidly. Unemployment rose to over 50% in some neighborhoods, and it was during this time that the first unemployed workers' movements arose. As the economic situation worsened, the government was finally forced to devalue the Argentine peso. Overnight, savings were cut one-third, and banks refused to allow people access to their money. On December 19th and 20th, 2001, the country exploded. Spontaneously, an enormous crowd surrounded the presidential palace, chanting, "Que se vayan todos," they all must go. When brutal repression failed to disperse the crowd, President de la Rúa had to resign, and in the next 2 weeks, three other presidential hopefuls were also forced from office. Llama el bombo y el piquete, corta la ruta. The following month saw an explosive growth of previous social struggles. More and more workers occupied factories abandoned by their bankrupt owners. Indigenous groups fought to stop their land from being sold to multinational businesses, and residents of downtown Buenos Aires began organizing neighborhood assemblies. But while the massive protests demonstrated the power of Argentine social movements, the path since then has not been easy. The current Peronist government of Néstor Kirchner and his neighborhood network of punteros has co-opted many movements with money and leftist rhetoric. Those movements that refuse to be brought under the umbrella of government power and neutralized have been isolated and repressed. Disagreements in strategies and outside pressures has caused internal conflicts among movements, leading to splits and ruptures. But many, including the unemployed workers' movements in Guernica, La Matanza, Río Negro, and Solano, have continued to organize and to fight. This video is a project to learn more about these groups and to consider how some of their lessons, tactics, and principles can help community organizers everywhere.
In the mid-1990s, as unemployment soared to over 50% in some of the neighborhoods on the outskirts of Buenos Aires, and jobs in the orchards of southern Argentina became seasonal and insecure, popular unrest grew. Not only had the government failed, but many elements of the traditional left were powerless to stop the damage of neoliberal reforms. Without jobs, for example, there were fewer possibilities for trade union organizing. Some activists and community members decided that the time had come to organize with the unemployed. In Rio Negro, home to Argentina's apple and pear orchards, one of the first unemployed workers' movements was formed in 1995, when their demands for government concessions of work subsidies and food were ignored. They adopted piquetes, the blocking of major regional bridges and highways, as a central form of struggle. Repression was swift and violent, but the movement's logic was clear. If we are left behind by your new economy, we will shut it down. The following year, more MTDs were started in the neighborhoods surrounding downtown Buenos Aires. The southern outskirts, an industrial zone with large waves of recent immigrants from the country's interior, as well as Bolivia and Paraguay, were a hotbed of political activity. In San Francisco Solano, a group of neighbors meeting at the local parish discovered the corruption of punteros and the Catholic Church in directing government subsidies. When the young MTD translated the concept of piquetes to the major roads entering the port of Buenos Aires, they too suffered isolation and repression. In Guernica, southwest of downtown, the origins of the MTD are similar. Members of more traditional leftist organizations, dissatisfied with their party's inability to adapt to the new economic picture, gathered together with community members. Faced with the powerful political network of punteros, piquetes were necessary to win the minimal government concessions that allowed families to survive, meager subsidies, and surplus food. The very visible piquetes were not the only change happening in the neighborhoods where these three MTDs operated. Between protests, they began organizing community projects aimed at increasing self-sufficiency. They created bakeries, communal food kitchens, organic gardens and farms, livestock, pigs, chickens, and rabbits, leather working shops, and brick making shops. They also dedicated groups to work on education and healthcare. Today, between the three MTDs, they have workshops and games, theater and dance, natural medicine and first aid, and they are currently building neighborhood clinics and free schools. And through their process of organizing and fighting, a set of operating principles were formed. They are autonomy, horizontality, and direct democracy. These principles were a marked change from the traditional left. Autonomy meant that the MTDs did not seek to effect change from above, did not want to take over the government or infiltrate the government by electing sympathetic candidates. Horizontality meant that all members of the MTDs had equal say in decisions. No boss or president could make decisions for everyone else. Direct democracy took the form of neighborhood assemblies as the ultimate decision-making body. To the west of downtown, in the industrial neighborhood of La Matanza, an MTD with a slightly different approach was formed. In 1997, they made a highly controversial decision not to accept government subsidies. The government was offering about 10% of the discounted food and monthly stipends to the unemployed workers' movements. The MTD La Matanza's refusal to accept these subsidies was based on their commitment to autonomy. Ultimately, they believed, the subsidies would lead to further dependence on the state, which they were seeking to avoid. In 2001, the MTD La Matanza occupied an abandoned school in which they wanted to form a community center. With the help of funding from non-governmental organizations and allies, they reconstructed the space where they now operate a cooperative bakery, sewing workshop, and a nursery school.
Autónomo, alojado de los partidos políticos y de los gobiernos y de todas las concepciones verticalistas, desde entonces, el MTD de Allen va abriendo un surco con sueños de libertad.
Cortamos la ruta del capitalismo, transitamos los caminos de la autonomía para avanzar en el cambio social.
Del sur que tantos han traicionado, yo en paz. armados hablan de paz. Su empata se ha embriado, soy la violencia. Y ellos armados hablan de paz. No me hablen de paz, no me hablen de paz.